Als Gesprächspartner hier am Institutional Money Congress haben wir Lars-Peter Hansen. Er ist Professor an der Universität in Chicago und einer von drei Nobelpreisträgern, die im vergangenen Jahr ausgezeichnet wurden vom Nobelpreiskomitee. Lars, you have done your presentation here at the Institutional Money Congress. Thank you very much. But one of your conclusions have been every model is wrong. So what sense does a model at all have for practitioners as well as scientists?
So when we talk about models being wrong, the question is, are they wrong in essential ways or are they wrong in inessential ways? We can't expect one model to explain all aspects of reality. You know, it's models have to be simplified along some dimensions. And the question is, are they simplified along dimensions that are critical to the question or ones that are largely irrelevant? And the only way, the best way I think to address that is to look at what happens when you kind of start changing the models a little bit. How much does that change the answers to the questions you really care about?
You showed during your presentation a little bit the history of statistics and statistical models, etc. What would you say, what have been the most important stations that we have seen in that development since the 17th century, if I'm right?
Yeah, so to me what's fascinating is the connection between statistical models and economic models. And how can economists use statistical methods in sensible ways to both do the typical statistician analysis of, say, well, let's take a model that's been written down by somebody else and investigate it, versus how do we think about people inside the models? Because in some sense, people inside our models have to be engaged in some form of at least informal statistical inferences. They look at data, they have to make guesses about the future. And so it's the connections between those two that I found fascinating, and statistics can help us think about that, those type of questions, because statistical analysis tell us when data histories are rich and when they're very sparse. And when they're very sparse, there's lots of room for people to disagree, there's lots of room for uncertainty and the like.
What explanation do you have that especially models, statistical models, if I think of Louis Bachelier, did find very late their way into scientific discussion and into real consideration, let's say?
Yeah, it is fascinating that Bachelier's work was pretty much not known by economists for 50 years. There's often concerns about, as you go across disciplines, that, you know, when one discipline discovers something, some other disciplines already known about that. And I think looking across disciplines, at least with an eye towards what goes on elsewhere, can be very, very valuable. In this case, it's all the more remarkable because Bachelet was writing about financial markets. It's just that people were not, you know, looking at the, it somehow dropped off the radar screen of economists and financial economists for many, until, you know, much, much later.
If I understood you well, you're not of the same opinion like Robert Shillow, who received the Nobel Prize together with you and Eugene Farmer. Shillow, he said statistical models or financial models and economics as a whole is not comparable to natural science, to exact science. You would be of another opinion, if I understood you well.
It's very interesting that one of Shiller's reactions to my Nobel address was that he had declared me to be a behavioral economist, which I'm not quite sure what that means, as I study behavior and economics. I guess I'm certainly that. Humans are very complicated entities, but and so how we model them is, of course, a challenge in a variety of ways. Social science, along some dimensions, is more challenging than physical sciences because of the complexity of individuals and their behavior. But I still think going at it systematically, going at it formally, can add clarity to the analysis and can help us make progress. So I'm a believer in models. Now, one of the ways I like to use statistical methods is if we look at data histories, we find out that histories on questions like how much do we know about macroeconomic growth rates and the like. If knowledge is very, very sparse, there's scope for lots of divergence in opinions, or scope for so-called behavioral biases, for prejudices to come into play. Whereas when data histories are very, very rich, then one would expect that scope to be much less. So I'm fine with, you know, pushing towards the field of behavioral finance, behavioral economics, as long as we make it something more formal and transparent so that econometricians like me can analyze the implications of the models.
Uncertainty is a very central aspect in your presentation that you did here at the Congress, but can you really explain, has there been a certain development, advancing in findings about uncertainty, or isn't uncertainty always the same?
So one of the fascinating things about uncertainty is kind of when we're thinking about the future, how much can we learn about the past? Now, if we look at the past and we think there may be some type of replications in the future, but we also worry that there's going to be something unique in the future that's going to be, that the past won't be very relevant for us. And that is a real challenge for model building, because uncertainty has to take into account the fact of unanticipated things happening to us in the future, and that's a very important source of uncertainty. So how to address that and allow for that, which I think is important, is certainly a challenge. What we've learned about uncertainty, I think we've gotten better models of better understanding of how people should, do and should respond to uncertainty in different ways. So I think our understanding of that has improved. Our understanding of how to narrow uncertainty uncertainty is kind of going to be with us along some important dimensions for forever. So we're not going to eliminate uncertainty, but I think what has advanced is how we think about approaches to uncertainty and how we imagine coping with it in sensible ways.
Thank you very much, Lars, for being with us here. Okay. Thanks a lot.